Hello everybody, it's Jamie from Old Shipping Lines and welcome back again to Chapters of War. And today we shall talk about Liberty ships. So yeah, let's begin. So first we shall talk about their use. Because what was their use? Liberty ships were a class of cargo ship built in the United States during World War II. Though in British in concept, the design was adopted by the United States for its simple, low-cost construction. Mass-produced on an unprecedented scale, the Liberty ship came to symbolize the US wartime industrial output. The class was developed to meet British orders for transport to replace ships that had been lost. And now we shall move on to their design. In 1936, the American Merchant Marine Act was passed to subsidize the annual construction of 50 commercial merchant vessels, which could be used in wartime by the United States Navy as naval auxiliaries, crewed by the US Merchant Marines. The number was doubled in 1939, and again in 1940, to 200 ships a year. Ship types included two tankers and three types of merchant vessel, all to be powered by steam turbines. Limited industrial capacity, especially for reduction gears, meant that a relatively few of these ships were built. In 1940, the British government ordered 60 ocean-class freighters from American yards to replace war losses and boost the merchant fleet. These were simple but fairly large for the time, with a single 2,500 horsepower compound steam engine of absolute but reliable design. Britain specified coal-fired plants because it then had extensive coal mines and no significant domestic oil production. These predecessor designs, which included the Northeast Coast Open Shelter Deck Steamer, were based on a simple ship. Originally produced in Sutherland by J.L. Thompson and Son, based on a 1939 design, for a simple tramp steamer, which was cheap to build and cheap to run. Examples include the SS Donington Court, built in 1939. The order specified an increase in draft to boost displacement by 800 long tons. The accommodation bridge and main engine were located amidships, with a tunnel connecting the main engine shaft to the propeller via a long extension. The first ocean-class ship, the SS Ocean Vanguard, was launched on 16 August 1941. The design was modified by the United States Marine Commission in part to increase conformity to American construction practices, but more importantly, to make it even quicker and cheaper to build. The US version was designed EC2 SC1 EC for emergency cargo, 2 for a ship between 400 and 450 feet, S for steam engines, and C1 for design C1. The new design replaced much riveting, which accounted for one-third of the labor costs, with welding and had oil-fired boilers. It was adopted as a Merchant Marine Act design and prediction awarded to the Conglomerate of the West Coast Engineering and Construction Companies, headed by Henry J. Kaiser, known as the Six Companies. Liberty ships were designed to carry 10,000 long tons of cargo, usually one type per ship, but during wartime generally carried loads far extending this. On 27 March 1941, the number of land lease ships was increased to 200 by the Defense Aid Supplemental Operations Act and increased again in April to 306, of which 170 would be Liberty ships. The ships were constructed of sections that were welded together. This is similar to the technique used by Palmers at Jarrow, northeast England, but substituted welding for riveting. Riveted ships took several months to construct. The workforce was newly trained, and no one had previously built welded ships. As America entered the war, the shipbuilding yards employed women to replace men who were enlisting in the armed forces. The ships initially had a poor public image due to their first appearance. In a speech announcing the emergency shipbuilding program, President Franklin D. Roosevelt had referred to the ship as a dreadful looking object, and personally I agree. I mean, if you look at the ships, they're not the most prettiest thing to look at, especially their color being full gray. The first ships required about 230 days to build, but the average eventually dropped to 42 days. The record was set by SS Robert E. Peary, which was lost 4 days and 15 and a half hours after the keel was laid, although this publicity stunt was not repeated. Several designs of mass-produced petroleum tankers were also produced, the most numerous being the T2 tanker series, with about 419 built between 1942 and the end of 1945. Now, with all designs, there are of course a little bit problems. And also there were problems with the designs at first of the early Liberty ships, which suffered hull and deck cracks. And actually a few were lost due to the structural defects. There were, during World War II, 1,500 examples of significant brittle fractures. There was even a ship, or Liberty ship, that sunk due to the fracture, which actually that the ship split in half without warning, the SS John P. Gaines, sinking with the loss of 10 lives. Now, suspicion of course fell on the shipyards, which had often used inexperienced workers and new welding techniques to produce ships in great haste. The Ministry of War Transport borrowed the British-built Empire Duke also for testing. And what they found out was that the fractures did not start in welds, but were due to low temperature embrittlement of the steel used. So the same steel used in riveted construction did not have this problem. She discovered that the ships in the North Atlantic were exposed to temperatures that could fall below a critical point, at which the steel changed from being ductile to becoming brittle. And now we move on to the third part of this story, and that is ready for their roles. In September 1943, strategic plans and shortage of more suitable hulls required that Liberty ships be pressed into emergency use as troop transports, with about 225 eventually converted for this purpose. While most of the Liberty ships converted were intended to carry no more than 550 troops, 33 were converted to transport 1,600 on shorter voyages from the mainland US ports to Alaska, Hawaii and the Caribbean. The issue of hull cracks caused concern with the United States Coast Guard, which recommended that Liberty ships be withdrawn from troop carrying in February 1944, although military commitments required their continued use. The more direct problem was the general unsuitability of the ships as troop transport, particularly with the Hastings conversions in 1943, that generated considerable complaints regarding poor mess food and water storage, sanitation, heating and ventilation, and a lack of medical facilities. After the Allied victory in North Africa, about 250 Liberty ships were engaged in transporting prisoners of war to the United States. By November 1943, the Army's Chief of Transportation, Charles P. Gross, and the WSA, whose agents operated the ships, reached an agreement on improvements, but operational requirements forced an increase of the maximum number of troops transported in the Liberty from 350 to 500. The increase in production of more suitable vessels did allow for returning the hastily converted Liberty ships to cargo-only operations by May 1944. Despite complaints, reservations, Navy requesting its personnel not to travel aboard Liberty troopers, and even Senate comment, the military necessities required use of the ship. The number of troops were increased to 550 on 200 Liberty ships for redeployment to the Pacific. The need for the troop ship conversions persisted into the immediate post-war period in order to return troops from overseas as quickly as possible. And some Liberty ships actually also went into battle, one being the SS Stephen Hopkins, but that will be a video for another time. Now, luckily for us, the war was won by the Allies. But what would happen with the Liberty ships now that the war was over? Now, more than 2,400 Liberty ships survived the war. Of these, 835 made up to the post-war cargo fleet. But sadly, some of the Liberty ships were lost after the war to naval mines. Now, there is one of the surviving Liberty ships with us still today. And that is the Liberty ship, the John V. Brown, which is now a maritime museum in Baltimore, Maryland. So even if they are not the most prettiest ships to look at, let us never forget the vital role Liberty ships played in our history. Thank you. And that is the end of another Chapter of War episode talking about Liberty ships. I hope you guys liked it. I hope I was understandable, and of course I hoped that you guys enjoyed it. Now, also, I quickly want to take a time to thank my new subscribers who have subscribed. It really means a lot. And if you have friends who like ocean liners, ships, or ocean vessels, please show them my channel. We are trying to reach 400 subs, and I know we can do it together. If you have any comments of this video or thoughts, please leave them in the description. And with that out of the way, guys, we will see each other on the next video. So have a good night or day wherever you are, and see you on the next one. Goodbye.